Hi, I'm Pete Gould with Gould Gear and Electric, and thanks for buying your vacuum pump kit from Gould Gear. Let's talk a little bit about what's inside the kit, and then we'll get into fixing your vacuum pump. Inside your kit, there's three plastic tools. This tool will drive a seal retainer in and out, and this tool will take the seal retainer out. There's a tool inside this part that's going to put the seal in and out. I'll go ahead and demonstrate how all that's going to work. But inside the kit, there's a bunch of written instructions and illustrations that are very helpful you can use in the shop when you're not looking at your DVD. The DVD is also in this package. Now the seal and O-ring kit inside here that we use is our own seal and O-ring kit. The O-rings are much better than what's in there. We use a dual lip seal also. I'll explain why we went to that seal. We also use our own gasket that's made by a company in Phoenix specifically for us. And this is an aluminum gasket, and it's covered on both sides with nitrile. Unlike the Cummins gasket, which was an excellent gasket, it had an O-ring inside just the center. This covers everything and prevents any leaks whatsoever. So let me show you a couple of the vacuum pumps that Dodge put in these trucks since 1989 clear up to 2007. Now this big old pump with two diaphragms on it was the first time that they put the vacuum pump on the diesel motor for the Dodge in 89 and 90, and the early 91s that weren't intercooled had this pump on them. They only used it 2 years. The power steering pump was pressed into the vacuum pump on this unit. Totally different setup. The problem that went wrong with these pumps, that's what I knew anyway, inside the front here was a dry bearing. It was a sealed bearing that went inside here. Unlike the newer style pumps like we're working on today, there are no bushings or bearings in the pump. It's all machine fit. And what would happen is the bearing would come apart inside here from the heat and lack of lubrication, and the balls inside the bearing would drop out down in the timing case and just destroy the gear, the cam gear, the crank gear, and blow a big hole in the side of the timing case cover. That's an awful big unit. So the next unit I'll show you is the three-section pump. And this pump they use from 91.5 up to 95. And this pump here is it's an oil-fed pump, and oil's fed in from the bottom. It has a bushing, a brass bushing in the front and the rear to keep the shaft centered, but it's identified as a three-section pump. It went from 91.5 to 95, and the pump has two 17-millimeter nuts in the back that hold it together. This rear extension holds a seal, which merely is pressed into the back here, and that's where your power steering bolts on the back of this. Now the other part of the pump has three screws that hold it together. There's one on the top, or two on the top, and one on the bottom. And they're 10-millimeter head screws, and that holds the center of the section to the front section. And that's why it's a three-section pump. You have the part that holds a seal and the bracket that attaches to the steering pump, the center and the front section, and that's a three-section pump up to 95. You shouldn't have that pump out of your truck to be working on. So let's take a look at the pump we're going to be working on. This is the pump that's in your truck right now. I'm going to show you a view of it out so you can have some idea what you're working on inside there. This is the two-section pump, and it has the power steering pump mounted to the back of it. Now there's four studs on the steering pump also that hold it into the back of this vacuum pump. And this is the oil line on the bottom that feeds oil into the pump to lubricate it while it's running. This is a gear-driven pump. There's a gear on the front that goes into the timing case, and this particular gear runs off of your injector pump. And this is a two-section pump from 96.5 up through 02. Now the front of this gear has a ton of letters and numbers on it. As you can see, And it doesn't matter where it goes back in, they don't have anything to do with the timing or anything. This merely rides off the injector pump, and you can put it back in however you like. Let me show you the last generation pump so far. This is a simple pump. This pump is driven exterior by a belt. It only has one diaphragm on it. And they put this pump in the Dodge diesel from 2003 up to 2007, and then changed it slightly from 07 on up through whatever they're at now, 2011. This is a vacuum pump, and it's only used where they use the Jacobs Jake brake on the engine as an accessory. Well, that's the end of the pumps. Let's go ahead and get on with what we're going to be doing here with your two-section pump. Okay, this is a two-section pump. This pump happens to be out of a 2000 model. It's the same pump from 96 and a half up, or very similar in a lot of ways. The only thing that changed on this pump really was the style of the rear piece, where they made the top a little bit rounder up here on the 97, 98, 99. This is squared off here. And a lot of the housings were all breaking and cracking right down the side here. And I think that's why they changed that design, to make it a little bit stronger. Now, when you take your pump out, or your vacuum pump out, it's going to have a steel gasket on it if it was in there from the beginning. And this is the Cummins gasket. It's steel, and it has an O-ring inset into it. A lot of people think it's a shim, and they put it back in. It's not a shim. And a lot of people call and say, mine doesn't have that. It did. It just, when you took the pump out, it fell down, and it's hung up down there somewhere. You'll see it laying around. But it had to have a gasket, or it would have leaked like a sieve. Now, the first thing you're going to want to do is separate your power steering pump. And I recommend taking the power steering pump off while the vacuum pump is still attached to the motor, and leaving it in the car. Leave the lines on the back. This one has HydroBoost, and you can tell it's HydroBoost because the back of the steering pump has two lines coming in. The early 96 and some 97s without a HydroBoost system only have one line coming out of them. Now, these lines are going to be on here. You're going to think they glued them on. They're really, really hard to get off. There's only about an inch of line on here in the clamp. If you want to save yourself some time, rather than twisting all over trying to get that line off and breaking these little joints loose, just take a razor blade and slit the rubber on both of them and take it off and cut your return lines that attach to these back off, and so you can put them back on again. That's the easiest way to get them off. Just slice them with the razor blade, pull them off, and cut them clean again to go back on. The return lines, it doesn't matter which return line goes to which return. If you get them mixed up, don't worry. There's only one other line, and that's the pressure line, and that goes in the bottom in this hole. So leave that. If you're not taking the pump out, you're going to leave both of these lines connected, and you're going to leave the bottom line connected. The only reason you take these off is if you're changing your steering pump. So what you'll do is, there's four nuts that hold the vacuum pump and the steering pump together. They're 15 millimeter head nuts. There's one extra nut on the lower left inside stud here, as you can see, and that holds a wire loom onto secure right up against the stud here. If you take that off, and you'll take your wire loom off, and then you'll start taking these bolts out, or the nuts. The nuts are 15 millimeter. Now, some of them are hard to get at when you're inside. These two here are pretty easy. You'll loosen them up, and usually the studs come out with the nuts, and that's not a problem. So go ahead and you'll take your nuts off completely all the way around. The top right nut, see that one came out with the stud. That's okay. Keep track of them. The right lower one is sometimes longer, the right lower side closest to the engine, because there's a bracket on it. To get to this top one, on the inside here is a bear, and that's what you're going to be looking down at from the top. And the problem is, the wall with a wrench, a lot of times is too thick to get onto the 15 millimeter head nut firmly to turn it. So you can use a thin wall socket, an open end wrench, or what I did after doing so many of them, I bent a wrench. I took an old wrench I had, a 15 millimeter, and I bent it so I could just reach in there from the top like that and loosen it up. So loosen all of your nuts up on the top and take them off. And then on the bottom, you're going to have on the lower right inside stud is this bracket. And this bracket here is going to attach to the engine. And it bolts onto the injector pump bracket. Take the little screw out that holds this end and also take the nut off of the bottom stud of the power steering pump and remove this bracket completely, and you'll be ready to slide your steering pump out of the vacuum pump. With all the nuts removed and the bracket off, this is the bracket. Something about this bracket, a lot of them cracked on the top here, on the very top edge. If yours is cracked, make sure you get another one, because it supports the weight and the torque of the vacuum pump and the steering pump when it's used. And if you need to know, if you want to write this down, the part number for that bracket, if you purchase it from Cummins, is 3919619. And that's a support bracket. Now what you're going to do here, the pump will still be bolted onto the engine. Just reach down there and slide the steering pump right out of the vacuum pump. Now what's going to be on the front of the steering pump is the coupler gear. Unlike other steering pumps that have a pulley up there, this has a little coupler gear. And there's two teeth on the end of it, and this couples up inside of the vacuum pump, inside a little drive disc that looks like this. I'll show you this inside the vacuum pump. And the vacuum pump inside has that disc, and the steering pump goes in this end, and there's a gear just like this on the vacuum pump shaft that's going to lock into the other slot here. So that's called the coupler disc. If you look close at this shaft here, you can see there's a little wear line from the old seal. And that line is what helps create the oil leak. So why we made a dual lip seal, when you put this all back together, that wear line that's on there is going to go in between the inner and outer lips of the dual lip seal, and the seal's going to start on a new area of this shaft here and prevent the leak. And that little grind mark there isn't an issue, so you don't have to replace your steering pump. Now just a real quick note, if you're putting a new steering pump in here, this area right here, or on a remanufactured pump, this round area that fits into the vacuum pump in the housing back here, it goes right into the seal retainer. What you want to do is make sure that all the paint, they put a ton of black paint on these steering pumps when they're remanufactured, and they get a ton of paint right on this area here. Make sure you sand it off. It's real critical, or it's not going to slide in here. When you go to bolt it up, there's going to be a gap, because this will not go in if there's paint on it, and you're going to wonder what's wrong. And if you try and tighten down the nuts on these studs when they're through this and there's paint on here, you'll bust his housing sure enough trying to get it tight. So we'll get on when we're putting it back together to tell you the importance of, when you're sliding this back in, the pump back into the vacuum pump, that you get these two drive dog teeth locked into this disc here just like that. And you have to line it up. It takes a little bit. And the way we do that is we'll put the pump back on the vacuum pump before we do that. And inside there, where the drive coupler is, where it locks up to, we'll turn this front gear, and that'll turn that for us. So I'll explain all that. So we'll set this aside here, and we'll get on to the vacuum pump. From underneath the truck, the next thing we're going to do is take the oil feed line off. And this is what you're going to see underneath the truck. Now there's a little brass fitting on the top here, and an 11 millimeter opened end wrench which really fits that the best. So you'll put an 11 millimeter wrench onto the brass fitting. Now this fitting here is 9/16, and you can use a flare wrench or an open end wrench to get on that good and come up from the bottom and hold the brass fitting and break the fitting loose. Now a lot of times this line here is oxidized, and when you turn it, this wants to keep turning and you don't want to twist the tube out by forcing it. And the best thing to do is spray a little bit of WD-40 right underneath this flare fitting here. And the best way to hold that still is to take a crescent wrench and lay it right across the curve in that tube like that. And that'll hold that still. And real slow, wiggle the 9/16 wrench back and forth till you break that oxidation loose, and then it'll come loose. And you can just clean it up a little bit when once you get it off there, and it won't give you any problem going back on. So just unscrew that off the vacuum pump. The other end will stay attached to the motor, and that's your steel rated oil line. Now you're not going to lose much more than a teaspoon or two of oil out of this when you take that oil line off, so don't be expecting 2 or 3 gallons to come out. Just snug your brass fitting back up if you loosened it, and just leave that in there while you're working on the pump. Now the front of the pump, from the bottom, you're going to go ahead and take the screw out of this hole. It bolts up just like a starter bolts on a motor, and these are 15 millimeter head screws also. And an extension with a little swivel and a shallow socket will get right to them. Sometimes they're pretty darn tight, and sometimes they come right off. There's two of them, one on the top and one on the bottom. You take those two screws out, and this vacuum pump's going to come right out in your hand. And on the front of it is the gear. And this gear goes into the timing case, and it turns off the injector pump gear. Now, first thing you might want to check on this gear, so that you don't put it back in broken. Let me get one. Make sure that gear isn't missing a couple teeth like this. If you look closely at this gear, you can see the teeth broke off. And these are all the letters and numbers I was telling you about on this gear. And they don't mean squat when you put it back in. You put it back in however you want to, and it'll go right in time. And anyhow, these teeth that you see on here that are broke off, this is pretty common. And a lot of times if you hear a tick, 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 that this vacuum pump gear is broke. And what caused that to break? 9 times out of 10, on the later model 98.5 through 02, someone changed the injector pump. And on the injector pump, they pull a pulley off from the front, and there's a locking pin inside of the gear on the shaft that keeps the gear from turning. And a lot of times when they pop that off, that little keyway drops down into the engine, and they don't bother getting it out, or they don't realize the keyway dropped out, and it lands right down on top of the other gear. And as soon as this comes around, when they crank the motor, it busts these teeth up here, and then the teeth start jumping around, and it tears everything up in the timing case. So get a look at your gear in the front there and make sure you're not missing any teeth, especially if somebody put an injector pump in it. And most all these trucks had the injector pumps put in them. Now, the other pumps from 96 through 97, if these are tore up, they had what's called a killer dowel pin in the front timing case. And there's a dowel pin that's punched into the timing case that falls out on a lot of them. They make a kit to fix that so it doesn't happen. In 96, 97, and early 98 had that problem, and that dowel pin would drop down in here and do basically the same thing the keyway that falls out of the injector pump does, and it just tears a timing case up. It usually blows a whole side in the timing case when stuff starts flying. So let's go ahead and take the vacuum pump apart. Now, with a half inch wrench, go ahead and loosen and remove the two screws that hold the rear section of the vacuum pump to the front half. A lot of times sometimes these are pretty tight. And you might need to tap the wrench with a hammer to get them loose. Two screws are out, simply remove the back half from the front half, and the pump will come in two sections. Now this is a coupler gear that's inside of the vacuum pump. What happens a lot on the four-wheel drives up around 180,000 miles, these two drive dogs on the end here that this coupler disc fits onto, they shear off. And if they shear off inside the vacuum pump, there's nothing left to turn the drive dogs on the steering pump, so you lose your steering and your brakes. Now if those two drive dogs that you see on there are broke off on yours, this disc will be moving all around the inside of this when you stick your finger in there. And this is what a pump looks like with the drive dogs broke off the end. Now a lot of people think that inside here, this little hole on the drive coupler gear itself, that there's a roll pin inside there. And that's what holds that gear on there, and it's not. That's an oil lubrication hole that's inside there. And the oil comes through this hole and lubricates inside the machine surface of the housing here, where it rotates, because there's no bushings or bearings or anything inside there. And this gear is pressed on, and there's a tool that we have to extract the gear, and we press a new coupler gear on there if needed. The 97 pump is a little bit different. In the 98 pump, the early one, this is a check valve. And inside here, there's a spring and a ball. And that keeps the oil inside of the pump. When it's not creating vacuum, that ball is closed, so the oil that fills the cavity here can't get up into your system. And the check valve looks like this on the 98.5 through 02, and on a 97-98 model, the check valve looks like this. Same thing, but they realized by turning this check valve up, they had even less oil enter the vacuum system. The 96 is similar, it just has a different check valve on here, and it's a narrower hole where it goes on. So let's go ahead and take the seal out next. With a clean rag, go ahead and wipe off the front of this rear section. And we're going to set it down on something clean, like a piece of cardboard that's soft. We don't want to ding or dent this up anywhere, especially around here. Where the seal goes, there's an O-ring goes there, and that's what seals it. You'll see some ring marks in the face of this. That's pretty normal. It's just from the rotor that's inside the back part, or the front part of the pump itself, this part here, rubbing up against it. And when you take this apart, you'll find some end play in it, the gear popping in and out and making noise like that. That's normal. That's okay that has that in there. So back to this front part. Inside here, this aluminum disc is a seal retainer, and this is what it looks like, and this is what we're going to be taking out of there. And underneath the seal retainer is the cross disc that is inside here, if you see it, the coupler disc we talked about earlier. The most important part of this job is to remember to put that disc back inside this housing in here before we press this back in, and I'll review that again. But before we take it out, what we're going to do is go ahead and take a magic marker, and real quick, if you want to, you can go ahead and mark this area right here with your magic marker and put a little line up on there. Just so you can index where you took that apart. And if you put your line on your seal retainer, when you're driving it back in, you'll know when it's all the way in up against its stop. Now the way we take that out of there, if you notice on this pump, these two legs on this side are longer than the other. So take the two screws that you took out of the pump to take the two sections apart and put them inside the two shorter legs. Now these two legs are level. We're going to turn this part over and set it down just like that. Now those two screws being in there keep that level, because we're going to drive the seal retainer out with the tool in the kit. And if you try and do it without those screws in there, this piece will be bent over on its side like that, and the pressure is going to make these two legs, the shorter ones, break. So go ahead and put the screws in them, set it down on the bench, and take the tool that came in your kit, a long skinny tool, and you'll see it fits right in the center there. And in the center, you're going to see the coupler disc, and that's what we're going to drive against to drive the seal retainer out. We'll back up a little bit here and we can see what's going to happen. Now with the plastic, now it might be a good idea to get you some safety glasses and put them on. And again, you don't want to strike these plastic tools with a metal hammer or they'll shatter. If you don't have a plastic hammer or a dead blow hammer, just take a block of wood, a 2x4 or something, and put it on top here and use a small heavy duty hammer, not a carpenter hammer like a mechanic's hammer or a small sledgehammer, just to drive this down, and we're going to knock the seal retainer out. So hold the tool in place and you see that the seal retainer now has dropped out of the vacuum pump, the rear section. And you lift this up, you look inside here, and the first thing you're going to want to do with a clean rag is wipe this out. And before you do anything, so you don't forget, go ahead and put this disc back into the vacuum pump. Remember, that little divot we talked about, it doesn't matter which way it faced. If you look at it when it came out and it was facing you, that little divot, just go ahead and turn it over and put it back inside here. Just drop it inside and move this part of the vacuum pump out of the way. Now this is a seal retainer that came out, and there's our mark on there. And what we're going to do with a clean rag is wipe this up for now. And this has an O-ring on it, and there's another O-ring in the kit. So take you a little pointed object or anything and go ahead and remove this O-ring. That's good. And set it aside. Now inside the seal retainer is the seal. That's it inside there. And when you're looking at it now, that's the flat side of the seal. And before we took it apart, if you looked in the vacuum pump, that's what you were looking at, was the flat side of the seal. On the other side, you'll see the spring side of the seal. And there's a groove in the seal, and inside there, there's a little metal spring that keeps the seal lips rubbing on the shaft. So we're going to knock the seal out next. Set the seal retainer down on the cardboard. And take the tool in the kit, the small tool that looks like this, and take the narrow end of the tool and just drop it right in on top of the seal, on the flat side of the seal. And take a hammer and hit the top of the tool and drive the seal out. You pick this up, there's the seal, and it came out from the inside of the seal retainer. There's the old seal. This is the single lip seal that comes out if it's the factory seal. We'll move the seal retainer aside. Now let's take all these parts that we took apart, and it's a good idea to get some kind of degreaser or something, some carburetor cleaner, carburetor spray, and get these parts all cleaned up, and let's go ahead and go and put it back together again. Now, with all of our parts all cleaned up, looking a whole lot better, we're ready to put the pump back together again. So you take the O-rings, there's two of them, out of the package, the seal out of the package. Before you go any further, remember, this is the most important part. Pick up the coupler disc and drop it back into the housing. If you don't put this disc back in the housing and you put the seal retainer back in without it, there's no way to get it back out again without doing a lot of damage. At the end of this video, I'll show you a trick to get it back out. If for some reason or another you did that, by all means, don't go from the other side and try and knock it out of there, or you'll ruin this housing, I promise you. So if you're getting that kind of problem, I'll show you what I do to fix it. The first thing we're going to do is take the seal retainer and turn it upside down so that the groove for this little O-ring is facing up. With a little bit of the green grease that came in the kit, go ahead and put some grease on the small O-ring. And take the O-ring and slip it over top and put it onto the seal retainer, just like that. Now the next thing we're going to do is make sure we get all the grease off our hands. Make sure there's no grease inside this cup at all. You might even wipe it out with a little bit of alcohol real quick to make sure it's clean. Pick up the new seal, and there's two sides to the seal. You have the flat side of the seal, and you have the spring side of the seal. This is the spring side of the seal. There's a little spring inside there that holds pressure on the lips of the seal to keep it up against the shaft and keep the oil in. So what we're going to do with the spring side of the seal facing up and the flat side of the seal facing down towards the vents, we're going to put the seal back into the seal retainer. Just take your fingers and get it started square into the seal retainer. Then pick up the small white tool. We used the skinny end to knock it out. Now we're going to use the large end to push the seal back into the seal retainer. We'll go ahead and start it by hand, trying to keep it straight, going down into the seal retainer. And it's tight, but make sure you put this in dry. Don't put any grease on the seal when you're installing it. Now, if you want to make it a little easier, put a little block of wood on top and push down again. Wow, so much for the piece of wood. Okay, there's a seal stop inside that stops the seal. Look inside and make sure that that seal all the way around is firm up against the seal stop. Okay, we messed up our reference line on here a little bit. That shows us where we drove this in and out. Really, it's not that important, but it does tell you when to stop if you're not sure you're all the way in or not, and you can generally tell when you're pushing it back in, but we'll still be able to use this line. So once you're sure that the seal is all the way in, good and flush, what we're going to do is put a little more grease around the seal retainer sleeve. Then put a little bit inside the housing and up around the edges where it's going to slide. Again, make sure that disc is inside. Very gently find your mark that you made and put the seal retainer into the housing. Now looking down in with your thumbs, very gently wiggle that seal retainer around. And watch that the O-ring doesn't pinch, like you see right there, and you cut the O-ring. You take it up a little bit, and very gently, again, push that in until it goes in just like that. It clicks. And make sure that that O-ring is flush. If you want to, you can take a pair of needle nose pliers and turn this a little bit, and it'll turn smooth. but you make sure that you don't pinch that O-ring putting it in there. Now set this back down again on something soft and make sure that the bottom is clean. One last time, make sure the coupler disc is inside. Now take your large white tool and put it on top of the seal retainer. And you can see your reference line again here. With a plastic hammer, we're going to drive the seal retainer back in. And right there, I can see that my line is right up against where I took it out. You can hear that the seal retainer's in. Now, if it's not in far enough, when you put your power steering pump back on here and slide it through, the legs of the vacuum pump won't touch the body of the power steering pump. And that's a dead giveaway. And never try to force this, the body, the two legs back here, or four legs, up against the power steering pump housing when you're putting it together. This should just slide right on, and once it's on there, these legs will be in contact, touching the body of the power steering pump. So that's how you put the seal in. Now let's go ahead and do the front piece. The front section of the vacuum pump, real quick, I'll talk about it with you. What's inside here is four vanes. And these vanes rotate, they look just like this. And they rotate inside here, and by centrifugal force, while this is spinning, the vanes come out, and this cavity is filled with oil, and they slide out and they grab the oil, and that's what makes a vacuum. And when they come back around again, they close. Now over time, when these pumps lose vacuum, what happens is the diesel oil causes a varnish on this vane, and they get all kinds of sticky inside there. And what you want to do is take some emery paper and set it down flat and take the vane and just rub the sides on some fine emery paper, and it'll take that varnish right off there. Keep them flat. And you can see it'll take that black varnish right off there. And make sure you're using like 300 grit. And just clean the edges of those vanes up so that they slide in and out of the rotor real free. And real quick, I'll show you what the rotor does. This is the rotor without the coupler gear on it. This one we're going to put a new coupler gear on. But the rotor comes out and the vane slides in and out with the round edge facing the barrel. It slides in and out like that, and it has to be free. The varnish makes them stick, and then you have no vacuum. Now when you put the vane back in, you can see when you look at the edge of it, they're worn and it's not a perfect circle. And the round edge faces out, and when you match the round edge with the edge of the rotor, you'll see which way that vane was in there. If you put it in backwards, it's pretty easy to tell. But you won't be taking this rotor out. What's behind that inside here, if you look, you can see a hole. And this hole right here is where the engine oil returns back into the timing case after it comes in from the oil feed line. Now if you look at the bottom where this ear is on that pump, you see how that's broken off? That's because somebody tried to put this pump back on the motor, and this part of the pump here fits inside of the timing case. And if they didn't have that straight for some reason, this was cocked, they only put one screw in at a time. When they forced that down, they broke this ear off here. Not good. Okay, let's get back to the back half of the vacuum pump. With this half all cleaned up, what you want to do next is fill this recessed area completely with the green grease that came in the kit. Just go ahead and do that. Okay, now in the front of this, you can see there's an alignment pin here, and this pin is going to fit into the face of the part that we just put the seal in, the back half of the vacuum pump, right up here. So we're going to take the big O-ring, and this O-ring is going to look like it's almost a little bit too big, but it's not, and it works perfect, just the size it is. And press it down in that grease all the way around into that cavity. And where that pin is, make sure you get it in there too. And just tap it lightly and get that down in the grease. It goes in there, it's not too big. And that grease will hold that in place. Now what we're going to do is pick up the other side of the vacuum pump. And we're going to put a little bit of grease all the way around the face of this and make sure it's clean. You can see where the O-ring is going to sit. And then put a little bit right inside here where the coupler gear turns. Now we're going to take the two halves and make sure your O-ring is still seated all the way down in the hole. And you see where the alignment pin goes? Go ahead and line that up and slide it back onto the vacuum pump. Now inside here, this is really important. You can see the drive coupler gear when you look down inside there. And what you have to do is reach in there with your finger and move the coupler disc around until it drops over top of the two drive dogs. And it sits in there good and flush, just like that. Now you'll see that the two housings are touching together like they should be. Take your screws and start the screws in hand tight. Again, make sure that the round coupler gear inside is down over top of the drive dogs. Otherwise, this would be cocked. The half-inch wrench, very slowly, start to snug the two screws up a little bit at a time. And these screws don't get really tight when you put them on. The torque, I believe it's in the spec chart in your kit, is 20 pounds. Or something like that. Just snug them up a little bit and turn the gear in the front and make sure it turns free. Go ahead and snug them down a little bit more until they're tight. And again, make sure the gear spins free. Now sometimes the gear, if you don't get these even going down, the gear wants to get tight on you. And in your illustrations, it shows to put a couple wedges in here to hold that gear forward real tight. So real quick, I'm going to show you how you do that. But the gear is, if you feel a binding or it's real tight, all you have to do, it shows to use two wooden wedges and drive them in between the gear and the space of the vacuum pump here to hold this thing dead center and forward so that the drive coupler gear inside of this housing is perfectly in center. And what you want to do is loosen these screws back up hand tight, just hand tight, or back them off until this spins free. And take a couple wedges. The best thing to do, if you could use a piece of copper tubing, regular half inch tubing, and just smash the end so it's shaped like a wedge or almost like a duckbill. Then right in line with these screws, go ahead and put these wedges in here and take a hammer and tap them in tight. And then on the other side, where the other screw is, put the other wedge. We'll put it in tight and put the other one back in. Go ahead and put them in there. See, the wood, you don't want to hit it in so hard you break the wood. That's it. When they're in there good and tight, go ahead and take your wrench and tighten these screws back down again. Then go ahead and take a hammer and knock the wedges out. And your gear will spin free. And that's all there is to putting that pump back together. And the next thing you'll do, of course, when you get ready to put it on, that's where the gasket goes that come in the kit. That'll go right on the front. And that mounts on like that when you put it up to the motor. Now, before you put this on the motor, you want to put the power steering pump back on to the vacuum pump. So, with the check valve facing up, and down in the well of the motor, if you left your steering pump on there, go ahead, let me pull this gasket off here. Take your steering pump, and the studs will probably still be in it, the four studs, and line the four studs up with the vacuum pump. At the same time, you're going to drive the coupler gear of the steering pump into the seal retainer. And these two drive dogs now have to go completely into the two drive dog holes inside of the vacuum pump in the coupler disc. So just push the two together. Very gently. As they come together, turn the gear in the front, boom. And you'll see that the two housings come completely together and touch. The vacuum pump is all the way up against the steering pump. And go ahead at this time and put your nuts back into the steering pump to hold it where it goes. Okay, with our power steering pump back on the vacuum pump, we have the nuts back on the two that you're looking in at from the fender side there, and you're going to put the other nut on the top, the hard one to get at, towards the engine, the right upper nut. Make sure that's on. Leave the little nut off that goes that holds a wire loom. Leave the bottom screw or stud out that holds this bracket. We'll put that on last when we put it on the motor. So go ahead and you want to drop this down into the well. And before you put it on the motor, get the oil line, which is going to be coming off the motor, and manipulate the pump and get that fitting started onto the vacuum pump before you put it on the motor. And get it just about tight. Because this thing's so rigid, it's almost impossible to get it back on once this is on the motor. So get it on there just about tight. Then get your gasket and put it on the front of the pump. And go ahead and lift the pump up and slide it onto the engine. The gear will go inside. Again, it doesn't matter how it goes in. Just jostle this around a little bit and it'll go in. Then just rotate your gasket up where it goes. It almost takes three hands. And take your two screws, put the one in the top first, a 15 millimeter head screw, get it hand started, and then put the one in the bottom in. Again, make sure that this ridge on here goes into the timing case and the vacuum pump is flush up against the timing case, so that we don't get this problem. That's all there is to it. Go ahead and bolt these, screw these nuts up tight. Snug it up good. Put your steering lines back on if you had the pump completely out. And you're ready to bleed the steering pump. Now, if you change the steering pump, there's only one way to get it working again, and most people don't know. And they take the pump off and get a new one, take it back because it doesn't work, take it off, get a new one. In the meantime, they're wrecking the new seal. And what you have to do, the easiest way to bleed this pump, is leave the cap off. Fill the steering reservoir with power steering fluid. Jack the front wheels off of the ground. Make sure they're off the ground. Start the motor and let it idle for a minute. And real slow, with this full, turn the steering wheel all the way to the left and all the way back to the right, one time. And bring it back to the center. Bring the RPMs up to between 950 and 1,000. And turn the wheel again, one time, lock to lock, all the way to the left, all the way back to the right. And you should feel it starting to free up a little bit. Turn the car or the truck off and come out and check the fluid level. What's got to happen is the fluid has to come out of the hydraulic tank, the steering tank, go all the way up behind the master cylinder through the hydro boost, push the fluid all the way down to the bottom of the frame where the steering gear is, fill the steering gear, the left and right valve bodies in the steering gear, and push the fluid all the way back up again to the return lines in the tank. And when it comes in through the tank, through these two return lines, it's blowing all that air in. And if you have air in the system, the hydraulics won't work. So once the air hits the tank, it'll make a little bit of foam and bubbles, but the air will come out the top. You're going to have to fill this once or twice while you're doing that. That's how much is going to drain. But remember to bring the RPMs up, and that'll force the fluid, once it starts going, all the way through the loop and all the way back again. Then let it idle for a little bit, turn it off, drive it, and you can check this after it warms up and it all the air bubbles in there dissipate. And you come back, check everything. Make sure all your nuts are tight. Check them one more time. Snug these two bolts up. Make sure they're tight. And the two in the front. And that's all there is to it. Well, thank you very much again for buying the kit. And please, by all means, if you have any questions at all, when you're starting this job or during the job, just give me a call. The phone number is on the card. Call toll free. I answer the phone 7 days, and I answer the phone in the evening. We're on East Coast time here. You call Saturday, Sunday, or whenever you're doing it. If you have a question, just stop and give me a call. I'll be happy to talk you right through it. All the instructions are in the kit. I hope this DVD helped you a lot. There's other things we sell for this truck that help you fix little things like this and save a lot of money. We sell a starter repair kit, and it's contacts and a plunger, and a DVD shows you how to do it. It's a really simple repair, and that kit's only $29.99, and it'll fix that starter every time. You'll hear that starter click once or twice when you turn the key, or it won't do anything, and then it'll start. It's time to fix it, because if you don't, the contacts inside the solenoid body tack weld themselves together and the starter keeps on running. Next thing you know, it eats the flywheel up or something. So if that starter starts clicking on you, give me a call and I'll send you one of those kits. It's simple, very simple. We also have a kit for the alternator, both the Bosch and the Denso alternator, and they're $34.99. And that kit comes with written instructions with the Denso kit. It's so simple you hardly need instructions. The only thing really ever goes wrong with them is the brush contact kit. And that's inside there. And it's just a cartridge, like a little cassette. And the brushes are in it. You don't solder them or anything. There's only three screws to take out once you remove the little cover on the back. And you just put new brushes in it, it'll go another 100,000 miles. If you need bearings, they come in the kit too, the front and rear bearing. And it's not a major job to do, but it'll sure save you a lot of money on that stuff. So that's all I have to say, and I thank you for this time. And again, if you have any questions about anything, just pick up the phone and give me a call. Thank you very much. And finally, the alternative to when you get all said and done and you got the seal retainer in and you look down on the bench and you forgot the disc. And hopefully, and please remember to put it back in, but it happens, people forget the disc. If you try and take the pump apart by putting something inside here and trying to drive it out, all you're going to do is mess up the inside of this. It happens every time. And you completely destroy the vacuum pump. So the way to get the seal retainer out is to take an 1/8-inch drill bit and drill a hole on the top edge of the seal retainer here, completely through the seal retainer. As long as you clean these edges up when you're done, the steering pump will just go right back in there again. It won't be an issue, it won't break or nothing. After you get the 1/8-inch hole drilled through there, get yourself a 5/16 carriage bolt or so, like this, and drill a hole through it right here. And what you're gonna do is get a nail or a strong piece of little steel like that and put the carriage bolt in here and take the nail and drive it through and through the carriage bolt and through the other side of the seal retainer and push it all the way in, center the screw, and you're kind of have something like this now. And the screw is latched onto the seal retainer. You take a piece of wood and cut a hole towards the bottom side of a block of wood. Go ahead and take the two screws that hold the center section together like we did before when we drove it out, and put them in the casting on the short side holes so you're level with these two. And take your board and put it over top like that. And now, oops, get that level like that. Take yourself a washer, put it over top of the board, and a nut, and screw it down on there. And now, when you take a wrench and you tighten this up, it'll extract the seal retainer by pulling it up. That's how you get the seal retainer out. Now the other way would be to tighten this up, and you can bend the nail over so it doesn't come through. And if you get this tight and it doesn't seem to be moving, you could still turn this over this way and you'll have the bolt through the nail there and put the tool back in it again. And now you have something to hit against without destroying the inside of the housing, and you can finish driving the seal retainer out. And that's how you could salvage that mistake without destroying the pump. Again, don't try and put a screwdriver or a chisel or a punch in there and knock it out, because it won't come out. That's the only way to get it out without damaging the seal retainer or the housing. And one more point I want to make. If you're in a shop, or if you have access to a bearing separator, which looks like this, just a set of jaws, they use a common on an axle bearing or something, and they're tapered, and it gets behind a bearing that you can't get off, and then they extract it like that. Well, rather than using the copper shims to pull the gear forward on this, to loosen it up so it doesn't spin, you can take the bearing separator, put it on the vacuum pump, and tighten the two screws down. Snug them up good and tight where the jaws of the vacuum pump are locked in behind the gear. Pull them good and tight, and that'll hold that gear forward really tight, and then finish tightening the two screws that hold the pump together And when you release the bearing splitter, again, when you take that off, that gear will spin free. And that's the way that a lot of the shops prefer to do it, if the gear tends to bind on it. And that's it. Thank you very much.